Hello boys and girls. In this video we're going to discuss the Riemann zeta function, a little bit of the Riemann hypothesis, and in particular we're going to implement the zeta function numerically. So we are going to be able to take any complex number and compute the return value of the zeta function. Moreover, apart from doing the actual implementation of having the algorithm that returns the complex values of the zeta function, we're going to look at Riemann's original paper. And also I'm going to start with 10 minutes or so an introduction to actually understand the thing before we do the implementation. So if you think you're already quite familiar with the behavior of the zeta function, you can probably skip 10 minutes forward or so, but I guess it will be helpful for other people watching before we get into it to kind of get a grip of having an intuition why does the zeta function, for example, give plots like this here. Okay, so let's get into it. The original definition of the zeta function as a function in the complex plane is given by Riemann in this super famous and very nice paper from 1859. This sort of sum has been discussed also before him, but he takes it as a function in the complex plane and defines some states some theorems about them and also relates it to prime numbers, number theory. This video will not at all be about prime numbers, apart from the fact that we're going to discuss the Riemann hypothesis, which has implications for number theory. So one standard definition, at least for some part of the complex plane of the Riemann zeta function, is through this infinite sum. So this is a sum over all natural numbers, or positive ones anyway, n equals 1 to infinity, the sum over these terms. Now this is 1 over n to the power of s, where s is any complex number with real part greater than 1. What he then does is, Riemann, is finding out how also to compute these values for s input values that are not, how to compute it for this domain, but also, you know, compute it for negative numbers and for complex numbers s that have negative real part. There's a caveat, there's one actual divergence at the value s equals real number 1. So if you plug in s equals 1, then this is the infinite sum over 1 over all n's, and this happens to diverge really in complex analysis. But otherwise, there's a way to move around in the complex plane and compute all the values for any other s. Okay, so here we have a plot. This is the complex plane. This is the point 0, 0. So here is s equals 0. And here is, for example, s equals 10. And here would be s equals 10 plus 20i, I being the imaginary unit. And then we see some colors here. And I'm not going to discuss the coloring here, but this is basically just a way to visualize the complex valued return values, right? So this is a function that takes complex input values and returns complex output values. And if you plot it on this two-dimensional plot where the inputs already take two dimensions, then and you have to kind of summarize the return value that is also two real numbers. It's one complex number as a return value, so it has two real components, the real and imaginary part. And then you have to have some strategies to visualize that. But basically we say that on the positive side, right? So these are the S values that have real part of S, let's say bigger than 2 here. This is an interesting domain there, domain of interest. This sort of looks almost a little bit more boring than on this funky colorful other side. And why is that? Well, let's first try to understand the Riemann theta function for just positive real values, right? Bigger than one. So for example, if you plug in s equals 7, then this is an infinite sum over 1 over all the natural numbers to the power of 7. And 1 over any number to the power of 7 here will be a super small number, right? For example, this the theta of 7 is 1 over 1 to the power of 7. So this is just 1. The first term is 1. Then the second term is 1 over 2 to the power of 7, right? This is some small number. 2 to the power of 7 is, you know, I should know that, I guess. Something in the range of 500 or so. This is like 1 over 500 is already small. And then the next term will be 1 over 3 to the power of 7. This is even smaller. 1 over 4 to the power of 7 is smaller and smaller. So all the new terms are very small. So this is going to be some small value, something is bigger than one, but not much bigger than that. And if you don't take 7, but for example take 11, then this thing, the individual terms are even smaller. So from that, it's kind of clear that on the real axis, bigger than one, the theta function is kind of this falling, has this falling curve. And if you take huge s, then basically only the first term survives. So this is a function that goes to one. It's quote unquote a boring function on the real number line. Of course, there's interesting things about the Riemann theta function on the real number line, but boring at least in the sense of like it's a monotonically falling real valued function. Okay. But if you like, again, take s equals 7 and then plus, let's say, an imaginary unit divided by 5. So 1/5 of an imaginary unit, right? We're going to get here. We are here, s equals 7 plus, and the small value, we're going up a little bit. What you then have here is that each term that is summed here is, for example, let's take n equals 20, the 20th term is 1 over 20 to the power of 7 plus I over 5, right? So again, as far as the real part goes, this is still a super suppressed number, it's a tiny number. But the imaginary exponent now makes it into something that essentially behaves like e to the power of I times some angle. So e to the power of I is of course cosine plus sine times e times I. So here we get then this oscillation. Basically there is a moving around on the complex plane involved in some fashion, and from this oscillation of the return values, then we also get then this oscillating structure. So here this goes up and down. So basically along the real line, this is a falling function, and then along the imaginary axis, this is has an oscillatory character. And we're going to see the sine and cosine expressions also in this video, because this is basically what we're going to implement to actually compute the return values. Okay, so I hope this kind of rough sketch makes it clear why the red part, you know, the positive part, looks like it does. In the bigger you go with the real values, the more it falls down. As soon as you go in the imaginary unit, you get a kind of oscillatory behavior. Okay, so this is one definition of the function. There are other sums which have a better convergence property, but this is the starting point and also where you get the easiest to see relation to the prime numbers out of it. Okay, then here we have some other representations of the theta function. This is an integral representation. It's also very interesting and nice. I love this kind of one over exponential function expressions, but I'm not going to talk about this in this video. There's also here, if you go on this page, the link to the a Wikipedia article about that old paper. And there I will show you in a second the references, also the transcripts to PDFs, and also German and English version of it. Okay, and then what he establishes in the paper is this formula here. So what we have here is, and this is kind of important to get a feeling for the theta function. He finds out that if we demand, and you know, we want a function that is it's complex differentiable, in you know, in places of, on the complex plane that are not equal to s equals to 1, this isn't the pole, but on all other places, if we want complex differentiability, which is a strong demand, then the function that we get out of it must fulfill this so-called reflection formula or functional equation here. So what does it say? On the one hand, we have the theta function, and it says the value of the theta function equals this kind of expression where we have here gamma function and sine terms. And also, again, the theta function, but with a negative argument s. So, for example, if we go back to our example, if you take s equals to 7 plus 1/5 of the imaginary unit, right? So s equals 7 plus 1 over 5 I, then this says that this equals the value, the return value of the theta function equals blah, 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 blah. And then theta of minus 6 minus I over 5, right? I just took the value s that I just set on and plug it in. So what we have here is a relationship between this the return value of the theta function with positive real part and the return value of the same theta function on the a mirrored point, right? So this there's a mirroring happen here. So you know, if you remember here some sines and gamma functions, if you scroll up again, they just said that some values here, the return value of whatever theta is here, equals the return value here, somewhere here, plus some oscillatory terms. And therefore, if we know the values here, and we know how to compute the sine and the gamma function and all these terms there, then we can also get the value here, because it's just a mirror image. You know, it's some factor times that value is this value. Okay, and once you know, have the functional equation, once you know, you can flip things around. You only need to compute the values here. And in this video, we're going to compute the values here with another sum formula. So there's one theorem that we're going to use apart from, you know, everything working out numerically anyway. Namely that there's this there's Dirichlet eta function. This is this eta here. This is very similar looking expression. We have an infinite sum over 1 over n to the power of s. But what happens is here is some oscillatory term. So his plus and minus flips all the time. So this will have a better convergence property. And as it turns out, this is the theorem that I'm just going to make use of. This sum and the theta function are related by a very simple like factor. We just have to do one complex exponentiation. And once we have this factor, then it doesn't matter whether we compute theta or eta, we always get the other one. So in particular, theta is expressible as this factor times, and then this better behaved sum. And this sum does not only converge for real part of s bigger than 1, but it actually converges on the whole positive, real positive side, right? That's that. So if we know how to compute the gamma function and sine and the complex exponentiation, then once we know how to get this sum, we can compute all the values. And then one more thing. So again, if you can look again at this formula, so there is a special value of s, namely, if you look at it here, like if you just consider the real number line, then if you plug in s equals 1/2, then you know s equals 1/2, 1 minus 1/2 is also 1/2, right? So if you plug in the value, and if this value there is not zero, then we can also, you know, divide this out, and then this thing must be one. In any case, we see that the reflection formula is actually a reflection on the line that has real value 1/2. You see that? Because like in the sense that this is a reflection formula, you know, I mean, of course, on the one half side, there's some this factor here, but a reflection formula in the sense of where you can reflect the return value to. If you look at this picture, it's again the complex plane. Here's the zero, s equals one, s equals zero real and zero imaginary part. Here is the positive real axis. Then, for example, a value here is proportional with a given proportionality factor to a value down here, right? This is the reflection, and the reflection is one around around this this point, basically this opa, the point 1/2. Okay, so in that sense, this axis here is special, if that makes sense. And now in Riemann's paper, you know, apart from defining the function in the complex plane and so on and so forth, he also finds, he gives a like a short argument that on the positive side here, they cannot be zeros. You can see that from some other sum representations. And then by the reflection formula, in that sense, this side will also be boring. Where the sign is, well, let me see, where the sign becomes zero, there's also special points, and so you have some special parts on the real negative line. Okay, but apart, these are called the trivial zeros. But apart from these trivial zeros, he finds that well, if there are zeros, then they must be in this strip here. Yeah, also here the top and bound, the positive imaginary and negative imaginary are related. So this is also not so interesting. But if you look at this strip here, let's call it critical strip, right? From zero to real imaginary one and up in the imaginary axis as far as you want, then he finds by complex analysis, you can do a line integral around an area. So for example, if you do a line integral here, then the return value of the line integral relates to the poles there. And so he does some, he computes a derived function from the theta function, does this, like looks at this, this area and finds there must be zeros there. Then he does computations and he finds zeros. They happen to all lie on the critical strip. And then he says, well, it looks like I expect all the zeros, of which the theta function seems to have many, lie exactly on this axis. And later it's found that, there are actually infinitely many, if I recall correctly, theta function zeros, established to lie here. But he's not able to prove that it cannot happen, that there is a zero inside the strip but outside of the critical line. So that's the Riemann hypothesis. Okay, so I think that's enough intuition to kind of grasp how the values might look like of the theta function. Here's another picture. What do we see here? What you can do is you can fix a trajectory in the complex plane. So for example, what they did here is they started here at 1/2 real part and then they go up in the imaginary axis. So this is this this line here, and you might go along this line and compute the return values of the theta function only on this line. Well, then you get a sequence, or you get a, you know, if you compute till 10 points here, then you get a sequence of 10 points, which are complex values. So these are two-dimensional. You can plot them, and this is what you see here. So, for example, this thing starts here, I think, and then if you go up in like, if you go up here, then you get the return values that happen to move around here. And what you see here, like if you go up to imaginary parts around 14, then it happens that the return value of the theta function at, you know, 14.13, blah 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 blah, happens to get closer and closer to zero. So here is the then your first actually zero of the theta function on this line, and then you go further, and then suddenly it comes again back again. So this means that if you go up here, the you get complex values which again and again come back to zero. So here are zeros on this line. This is what you can visualize here. And we, in this video, we're going to implement a way of computing return values of the theta function. And if I run this up front to demonstrate, then what we get out of here is exactly this plot. I computed to some precision. And I want this to evaluate quickly, so it's a little bit edgy, but that's the plot. Okay, so everything seems to work out fine. So far, so good. Okay, so let's leave this Wikipedia article behind. I want to point out the, here is this, they have a dedicated Wikipedia article to the a famous paper. If you go to the bottom here, you find these English and German transcripts of it. So here is the German paper, but I, since I guess most of my audience is English speaking, go to the English one. So this is the same paper, but translated to English. If you read the German and know German, it's funny to read because it has a kind of old language, which is nice, like old German. So this is the same as you can see, but just in English. Okay, Riemann, he wrote only this one paper of on number theory. The rest has like, as far as I understand, are not number theory papers of his works, which is interesting given that he basically found this new analytic number theory subject by making these discoveries here. But if you look at the paper, his techniques are very, like, he's very strong in Fourier analysis, and this is what the how he his angle to this thing. He works a lot with this function here, this xi function, which is, I think, the theta function shifted. So if you see this function in the paper, think of it like the theta function, but just the values shifted a little bit. Maybe I have the definition here somewhere. Well, I don't want to spend too much time on it. This is the gamma. This is also the gamma function shifted a little bit, and then here is this relation. It works with this function often. Okay, and here is the interesting section. So this is page number 4. You can hold on and read it if you like. He discusses here. He gives his argument why the zeros must lie in between 0 and 1, or in his terms, for this function, between minus, you have to look at the function definition to make the translation, but it's basically talking about the zeros being between, in this strip between 0 and 1. The theta function, he's interested in the zeros, because up in the paper he discusses how the zeros relate to the prime numbers. And then if you take the logarithm of a function, and then when the function becomes zero, the logarithm of zero is diverges. So this function log of the theta function has poles at the zeros of the theta function, right? And so if you do your complex analysis and do line integrals, then you can find poles, and here that means finding the zeros. And then he makes this estimation. He says, indeed, there are zeros there, and the number of zeros is basically this value where t is how far you go up in on the imaginary axis. This is the function you have to evaluate if you do this contour integral. And then he says, he tries it out a bit, and he finds these zeros, and he says, one now finds indeed approximately this number of real roots within this limit. So if he says real roots, he means that they are lie exactly of this on this axis at 1/2 in his terms. And it's very probable that all the roots are real, because he has his evidence from his computations. Certainly, one would wish for a stricter proof here. I have meanwhile temporarily put aside the search for this after some fleeting futile attempts, as it appears to be unnecessary for the next objective in my investigation. So here, these few lines, this is the Riemann hypothesis. This is where it popped up, this kind of guess. Well, it looks like all the zeros in terms of the theta function have the real part 1/2, and so that's the origin of this spiel. This is a short paper. It only goes on for like about 5 pages, but this is the famous part. It's also funny to like, not only is his German old German, like he has a lot of H's splitted throughout his text. So for example, if he writes this is for German speakers, if he writes in der Tat, das ist in der Tat so, and then he writes in der Tat with THAT and stuff like that, it's nice. And also his nomenclature is interesting. For example, he doesn't write T squared here for some reason, but he like writes TT. Okay, maybe the, well, I guess he has exponents, right? We'd have to look at the original paper, I guess. Then this is more coming back to prime numbers and counting densities and all these kind of things. Okay, so much for the paper. Then before we finally go to the implementation, I want to point again to the there's also an article in Dirichlet eta function, defined like so with the alternate exams. So this is defined in a way that the first term is again positive. That's why you see this n minus 1 here, in case you were wondering. This is because the sum starts not at 0 but at 1. So to have the first term positive, this is a 1, so to speak. And this Wikipedia article, they discussed the history a little bit, but I already pointed to that in the other article. Okay, so here's how we're going to tackle that. We're going to implement, as I said, this version. Okay. This is the page I wrote down where I have then the implementation. Some notation. I write phi of n for the logarithm of n, because the logarithm of n will pop up, and this object kind of makes the computation a little bit nasty. But this is just a shorthand. And then one observation: if we have n to the power of it, where t is a real number, right? And think of t as going around an axis or in the imaginary direction, no matter what the real part is, some axis somewhere. Then with the standard rules, you know, you write this standard trick, e to the power of log, it's an identity. And then you can pull out the exponent. So this becomes e to the power of it logarithm of n, which we here define as phi of n. And then this is, of course, cosine plus I sine, right? So this thing, and this is kind of the part you have to see to convince yourself that it's indeed not hard to compute the values of the Riemann zeta function, at least to an approximation. this object is just cosine and sine. So this object is basically lies on the unit disk, unit circle. But the behavior, like the way in which this thing rotates as a point on the unit circle, is kind of weird, because the if you go up in, like if you fix t, let's say t is 7, and you go up in with n, right? First, n equals 1, then this thing is 0. So we start out with just 1. And then n equals 2, then you turn kind of by an angle of logarithm of 2, and then logarithm of 3. And you go on in a circle, but since the logarithm is so slow growing, you kind of get slower and slower there. Right? You see that? Okay, this is not necessary to actually understand it if you just want to implement it, but this is kind of how you can imagine. This is kind of this circle which is slower and slower winding. And yeah, I define a theta function, I define an eta function. And of course I used 1 over n to the power of s equals n to the power of minus s. So x and y are going to be my real and imaginary parts of s. And as already discussed, if we are on the real positive side, theta can be expressed through this thing. And so we just need to evaluate that object here, right? And so that means if we take s and split it up the real and imaginary part, then theta of x plus iy, so this is s, is this thing plugged in with s equals x plus iy. Okay, and then you can you rewrite this object as this object. This is simple, just using exponential rules. Then times sum over this alternating thing, the real part is just the suppressing factor, and then times what we just stated about sine and cosine, right? Except here I used the letter t, now I use the letter y, because that's how we know it. Okay, so for example, you can try out special points immediately, and if you go on Wolfram Alpha on the internet, if you take x equals 1/2, so if you let yourself, if you focus in on this the center of this strip here on this crucial axis here, then for example there's this Basel problem which says what is actually the sum over all terms 2 to the power of the sum over 1 over all natural numbers to the power of 2, and that famously is equal to pi squared over 6. And you can take this expression that I find here and plug it into this thing is a Wolfram Alpha or Mathematica special case of this, and plug it in, and you will find indeed this is true. Why is this exactly that? Well, for x equals 1/2, this thing is the square root of n, and also if we set imaginary part to 0, y equals 0, then this is a 1, this is a 0, and so we are left with the sum over all natural numbers alternating divided by the square root of n, and that is the Basel problem that turns out to be, like this turns out to be the value that is the return value of the Basel problem as well. Okay, this is just an example. So this is the thing. So now actually, what is the Riemann hypothesis in terms of this expression? Well, if you said x equals to 1/2 again to be on this critical line, then there are zeros on there. So that means what is a zero in terms of this thing? Well, here now the nice thing about this expression is that I separated clearly the real and imaginary part, right? So okay, this factor is not so interesting, because once we know when this is zero, then we know when this is zero, right? Here's a multiplication, so to compute the zeros we're really only interested in the hard part. So when is this infinite sum here zero? Well, to be zero as a complex number, both real and imaginary part must both be zero. So for this to be zero, the sum over this thing times the cosines must be zero, and at the same time, you know, given fixed x and y, at the same time, the sum of this of the y's must be zero, right? So the claim that there is for x half some zeros on this line means that there are points y, for example, y equals to 14 dot something something, happens to be such a value, such that both of this sum, this sum over the cosines and the sums over the sines, happen to be zero at the same value. And the Riemann hypothesis is now that if you take any x between 0 and 1, but not 1 half, then it will never happen that both of these sums are 0 at the same time. That's the Riemann hypothesis in terms of this object. Okay? Okay. Yeah. So, all that said, now we get actually to the code. So this is actually the same file, but I will switch to the editor so we can actually see syntax highlighting in Python. This is what we just discussed. I'm going to use the plotting library and NumPy library. This is going to be very quick because it's very simple. So first I'm going to compute zeta divided by eta. So this is, this is this thing here, okay? Zeta divided by eta is exactly 1 over 1 minus 2 to the power of 1 minus s. This is this object, or this object, if you will. Well, I will use the Python complex numbers, but I will also show how to do that in purely real terms. The first is the complex number one, which is super simple. We compute this expression is this expression. You can see this easily by multiplying the numerator and denominator by this 2 to the power of iy and using the exponentiation rules. So this is how I implemented literally there. Say some number like x being minus 2 to the power of 1 minus x. This is this thing here. And then another number y, which happens to be this 2 to the power of iy, right? And then the result of this term is y divided by x plus y. Okay, this is the one way. Although here I'm using complex numbers from Python. This is the imaginary unit in Python. Now, if you don't want that, here's how you can do it, like, explicitly. If you use just the, you know, this is really complex numbers 101, you multiply by a number which is the conjugate of the denominator, and then the denominator is real, and then you just have to separate the denominator that you get into real and imaginary part. By the same rule, you know, by the same trick here, I can split it up in sines and cosines, and if you use this again, then you will find exactly this object here. So this is another way of writing it. You have some real part, some imaginary part divided by some number. This is a real number, and the real and imaginary number happen to be this. So you can do that with pen and paper if you like, but if I would comment it out, it would tell me, yeah, this is exactly the same thing, you know, up to numerical error anyway. Okay, so now we have zeta over eta. So now we have this multiplication factor. We don't have to think about it anymore. And now the zeta function is literally only these few lines. Very nice. So we are going to compute 5,000 terms whenever we call the zeta function. We compute the real and imaginary part separately, right? The real part is the sum over this times the cosines. The imaginary part is the sum over this times the sine. Yeah. And then multiplied by this thing. So the first term that is common with both is this expression. You know, you can also write n minus 1 to be closer to what I wrote there in this text. And this phase phi, I call this p here, times y. I mean, maybe I should stick to the same notation. In which case that's like so. Of course, I did it in a way that, let me do it like this actually. Let me write py here. This is the phase times y. And so it, of course, you know, for every n, I just add this cosine and sine term with this a. A is this suppressed alternating object, and that's basically it, right? There's a minus sign here as well. If that's not clear, this is because here I had this t was positive, right? But here is n to the minus s, and therefore you get minus y on this side, and the cosine is symmetric, but the sine is anti-symmetric, and so you can pull out. I could also write minus y here, I guess. I could also write here a plus and here a minus. Should be the same thing. So, but I think this is nicer like this. Okay, so that's why there was one minus sign. It's from the inversion of in the zeta function definition. And so we compute the real part. This is infinite sum, or we computed it anyway to some thousands of terms. And the imaginary one. Then I add this imaginary unit again to make use of Python multiplication one time. This is a complex number, and this is the eta that we just computed. And this is the result. And then I return the real and the imaginary part separately, and this is how you compute the zeta function values, right? So what I did here is this small test function, you know, tutorial runs of 1/1000 anyway, compute these values for my zeta value for floating point numbers for free values, and then I check the real and the imaginary part separately if they are the values, and I computed those on Wolfram Alpha. You know, I'm not going to bother computing the zeta function with another program now. Could also do that, I guess. You can believe it at the very least here on with this value where I compute zeta of 2 and 0, which we know is the Basel problem, which should be pi squared divided by 6 and has real value of 0. And this actually turns out the right way. So you know, you can see if I implemented this wrongly, then in some way, then, I plug in here y0, then the sum is especially easy. But in any case, you can go and plug in these values on Wolfram Alpha, and you will find the real part of the return value of zeta. And you can do Wolfram Alpha or any, you know, program, whatever. The notation would be this thing here. -5.i. So if you go to Wolfram Alpha. But then I don't want to wait for the computation now. Then you will get exactly this real part and this imaginary part. Okay, so this is just a test anyway. You have already seen that once I call this, it actually works out. But I will do it in a second again. And then anyway, this is just normal Python plotting. So I want the number of points. My precision here, I define this as the number of points per I. So per imaginary. So if I go here from imaginary part 5 to imaginary part 6, I want to have 3 points on that. This is my precision to which I resolve this on the complex number line. Like here I compute a bunch of points and I collect just the return values of zeta. And then every third value, I also plot the label on the graph. That's why you see the axis. And then I take all the data and plot it. I do that, firstly, let's do it for the 1/2. So this is exactly here. We start here And we go up 90 points along this axis, plot them, and we get real and imaginary parts of the zeta function as return values, and then plot them on the axis. So if I do that, then we get this image. Actually, let me actually plot it to a little bit of a higher precision. We're going to have to wait for a little bit, but okay, let's go with here 5 and let's go here to 130, simply so the plot hopefully looks a little bit nicer. Let's actually go down to 200. Okay, so this is a little bit smoother now. It's not great, but it's doable. If I do the precision higher, then this edge in this corner here will vanish. But okay, that's fine enough. So what we see here, if you plug in the direct value, you know, the value of the theta function at real part 1/2 and imaginary part 0, then this value has its own. This value has its own decimal expansion on the encyclopedia of numbers. Actually, this is minus 1.4 something something. So this is actually this point, minus 1.4 something. And then if you go up, I suppose this would be 1/5 or so. What did they use for values? Yeah. So here you see my t value, like on the axis, is this here. So this point should be 1/5. So this is real part 1/2, imaginary part 1/5, and it's this thing, and this then is you know, real part 1/2, imaginary part 2/5, and so on and so forth. And so we move along here then, and then suddenly, eventually, once we get to this is a little bit messy, I have to say. Okay, let's actually maybe go down with this again. Let's actually stick with that. Because the labels are so dense, that's why I cannot properly read it. Yeah, okay, so here, for example, yeah, I guess these numbers are already like one. Here's one. So this they now get the succession gets seemingly smaller here, and this point. You know, if I interpret the graph correctly, it's a little bit too many labels. But I guess here the point here somewhere is y equals 11, and then once it gets to y equals 14, you know, y equals 14 dot something something. Suddenly the real and imaginary part of the return value happen to be both to be close to zero, and in fact there's this 1 0, this is exactly zero here, of the Riemann zeta function at 1/2 plus 14 something. Yeah, and then we go on, we get further along the imaginary line, then we, you know, I cannot tell from this graph which, you know, thing this is, but I suppose it goes along here. No, but I can tell from the graph here, it's this one in the middle. And then suddenly at, I don't know, on the point 25 up or so, roughly, it goes again through it. So there's the second zero on the critical line, at 25 something. And this goes on and it comes back again. And so if we do that, there would be an infinite number of coming back to the zero, actually. And just for demonstration purposes, if I go real value a little bit higher, let's say 4/5. Okay, so this is, you know, this is the x value for this plot. Do the same spiel, I compute 100 points, but now I shift the axis a little bit to the right. So now previously we have computed these values here. And now I'm going to shift the axis a little bit to the right here. So I'm just going to shift the axis here. I'm going to compute points here on this line. Then let's do this. Then what we're going to see is that the Riemann hypothesis, at least numerically here, is true in that here's the zero and this thing never touches the zero. It doesn't even come close. As far as closeness goes there in terms of distance in complex numbers, this whole blob moves away from the zero. So there are no points where the real and imaginary return value of the zeta function is both zero at the same time. So the statement, the Riemann zeta function, the Riemann hypothesis claim is then no matter what you do, if you go away from 1/2 with x, then there will never be another spiral which ever has both real and imaginary part of the zeta function zero. Okay, I guess we leave it there. I hope this was informative. Namaste, take care, and have a good weekend.